Hello all, this is Dr. Alsop here, and in this video we are talking all things sternocleidomastoid muscle, or your SCM. It may seem a bit odd to have a whole video devoted to just one muscle, but this is a big one when we're talking about the neck. It not only is a large and long muscle, but it's important in forming boundaries for the cervical triangles in the neck, so it is a pretty big deal. In addition to understanding location, after reviewing the learning objective text in this video, we should also understand what actions occur with sternocleidomastoid muscle contraction, as well as what innervates these muscles. All right, so one of the great things about the sternocleidomastoid muscle is that it is named based on its attachment sites. It is attached inferiorly by what we like to call two heads, meaning that there are typically two tendons. There is the more rounded sternal head, which is going to be a little bit lower down here, and the thicker and kind of fleshier clavicular head. So that's where we're getting the sterno and the clido. Clido is meaning clavicle. The superior attachments include the mastoid process, which would be right about here-ish, and of the temporal bone. So the mastoid process is of the temporal bone. And a thin aponeurosis will extend into the lateral half of the superior nuchal line of the occipital bone, so it'll continue back towards this region. The sternocleidomastoid muscle is efferently innervated by the accessory nerve, which I'm tracing right here. And you can see it kind of spanning between the sternocleidomastoid, which has been reflected here, and the trapezius muscle here. It will innervate both of those. But before we get into that, really, what does efferent mean? It is basically synonymous with motor innervation, so messages sent from the central nervous system to an effector organ. So in this case, we're talking about a muscle. It will send signals which will lead to muscle contraction. The accessory nerve is an entirely efferent nerve, even though there is some research which is a little wishy-washy there, but for the most part, most fibers are efferent fibers. Most typically, a muscle is both efferently and afferently served by the same nerve, meaning that that nerve will have both motor and sensory fibers wrapped up together. But this is not the case for the accessory nerve, so we need to have afferent innervation from another source. So let's get into the afferent innervation. When discussing sensory or afferent innervation in regards to muscles, this is the means by which the central nervous system can understand what is going on with that muscle. Where is it located? Is it moving? Things like that. So a fancier and more accurate term for this is proprioception. All right, so proprioception will convey information to the central nervous system regarding positioning of a joint or the degree of tension in a tendon. So this is a complex concept, so this is the best way I can think to demonstrate it. I want you to put your hands behind your back. Now wiggle your fingers. Do you know that this is happening? Do you know that your muscles are contracting and your joints are moving to wiggle your fingers? This is proprioception. So if the accessory nerve is entirely composed of efferent fibers, where does the sternocleidomastoid get its afferent innervation? Well, it's from C2 and C3, of course, so fibers from C2 and C3. The C stands for cervical, so the afferent fibers, or it's going to have afferent fibers from the second and third cervical spinal nerves. And you can see a little bit of those right in this region, so also kind of entering into the deep portions of the sternocleidomastoid. Okay, what about what provides oxygenated blood to this muscle? What is the arterial supply to the SCM? It gets a supply from numerous small branches, kind of throughout its course of the muscle, but its dominant supply is the sternocleidomastoid branch of the occipital artery. And the occipital artery is a branch of your external carotid artery. So you got to have that blood supply to have a fully functioning muscle. Lastly, let's talk about what this muscle can do when it contracts. An important concept regarding muscles is that a muscle must cross a joint to directly affect actions at that joint. So directly meaning that it will directly play a role in moving that joint. So just looking at where this muscle is located, and the fact that we know based on its attachments that it is crossing between the skull and the sternum and clavicle. So it's crossing all these cervical vertebrae right here, as well as the craniovertebral joint or that atlanto-occipital joint. So not only the atlanto-occipital joint, but the cervical intervertebral joints. So what this muscle can do depends on whether only one sternocleidomastoid muscle is contraction or unilateral contraction, or both sternocleidomastoid muscles are contracting at the same time, or bilateral contraction. So with unilateral contraction, you can get lateral flexion. That's what this arrow is indicating here. Lateral flexion is in the coronal plane. Think of the head trying to meet the shoulder of the same side, as well as rotation, which is what this arrow is indicating. So that chin is kind of moving up. So when you put these together, you have a head tilt with the chin facing up. Kind of think about looking at the ceiling. With bilateral contraction, you get flexion of the cervical vertebral joints. Think touching your chin to your chest. So flexion or a bending in that region. There are a few other movements that the sternocleidomastoid can play a synergistic role with, but you are not responsible for these. All right, so that is the sternocleidomastoid muscle in a nutshell. I told you we would need a full video. Now let's review a concept. And this is a classic true or false question. True or false? Injury to the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, would affect proprioception associated with the sternocleidomastoid muscle. What do you think? First, stop and remember what proprioception is. And after that, I hope you have landed on that this statement is false. All right. The accessory nerve is entirely efferent or motor. Proprioception is associated with afferent or sensory innervation, which the sternocleidomastoid muscle receives from fibers of C2 and C3. All right, great. This was so much fun. As you review, please do reach out with any questions, and I will see you in the next lecture video. Have a great day.